Good morning to all of you once again. After that brilliant blended session having online and offline presence, we now move on to an equally interesting plenary talk. And here we are going to have a session that focuses more on the university of the past and the university of the future. And to share their insights with us, we have with us today Mr. S. Giridhar, Mr. Gopal Devanahalli, and Professor Mangal Sundar, the session chair. May I kindly request you to come onto the dais? They are here. They're right behind you, sir. Mr. Giridhar is the Chief Operating Officer of Azim Premji University. He is one of the earliest members of Azim Premji Foundation, and he also writes from what he observes and experiences. Mr. Gopal Devanahalli is the Chief Executive Officer of MeritTrac, and before joining MeritTrac, Gopal headed digital initiatives at Manipal Global. Professor Mangal Sundar, today's session chair, is a well-known name associated with NPTEL at IIT Madras, a professor of chemistry. His major interest is in the area of technology-enhanced learning. I now hand it over to Professor Mangal Sundar.
I would assume that about 10 to 15 minutes should be for discussion with the audience. Good morning. Let me, and on behalf of my panel colleagues, thank IIM Bangalore and the IIMBx IIT Bombay and all the other partners of this conference for the opportunity to talk to you and to share with us. The topic is, of course, it's very, very glamorous. What's the role of the, future universities? I wouldn't know, but we'll share some ideas. There is a brief presentation. I think the organization of the plenary would be that, I assume about 5 to 10 minutes we would discuss, and not more than that, and about half an hour we close, and then 15 minutes we can have questions. I hope that's okay with all of you. Okay. So if they can find my presentation, yes, that's the first one. Yes, please, yeah, IIMB. It's a very, very cursory note, okay? The likely role of the universities in the future, as see my coordinates are all there. I want to read out to you a very beautiful quote. No, no, that's okay. I have something else. It's not there. Don't worry. I'll read out from here. Oh, there's also quotations on the file. Yeah, please do that. Yeah, that's a quotes file. Yeah, the first one is extremely useful. The first one, the power of instruction is seldom of much efficacy except in those happy dispositions where it's almost superfluous. This is a beautiful educational note by Professor Gibbon of Stanford many, many years ago. And I came to know of this quote from Richard Feynman's volumes on the lectures on physics. And Feynman gives a solution right next to that on how it's possible for us to reach out to a very large number of people with very, very good presentations. And of course, all of you know, Feynman's lectures on physics are 60 years old now, almost 55 years old, and they are the best books. Again, the other quote that I think the universities and all of us should be very careful about examining is the Steve Jobs quotation. This is from the Stanford convocation address that he gave. Again, you can't connect the dots looking forward. You can only connect them looking backwards. So you have to trust the dots will somehow connect in your future. You have to trust in something, your gut, destiny, life, karma, whatever, because believing in the dots will connect down the road will give you the confidence to follow your heart. I think that's the role of the universities in the future. And let me go back to my presentation and just give you a very quick overview of what I think is where we are and where we should be moving. Okay, you should also tell me. I should finish at 10 minutes. I'm not the chair, I'm one of the speakers. Next slide, please. Yeah. Okay, this is the problem that we have today. Approximately in India, approximately 24%. I think the data is slightly older, but I think we can get the numbers over a period. The gross enrollment ratio in technical education and about 600, oh, this is, thank you. About 600 universities, 14.6 million students about 3-4 years ago, and 0.2 million teachers with PhD and teaching experience, and UGC projects substantial increase. And the distance education has about 8.7 million students. And about 3 million students were at one point of time in the Indira Gandhi National Open University. They may correct me on what the current number is. It's approximately the same. The country of 1.2 billion, we are looking at three sectors: technical, arts, science, and distance education account for 30 million students at a given time. This is a slightly older figure, maybe we have more. But the people who can learn, given an opportunity to learn, will have to be at least five times that. Okay? If we have to increase the technology component of our country, we have to increase our GER at least three, four times. This is where we started. I think that was the year I was recorded. I was born as my record, 1956. I don't mind revealing my age. 5 MB hard disk IBM being airshipped because of its weight by the Pan American Airlines. And you can see the 4 MB hard disk in a cold storage in an institution. And the computer with which I actually started typing my thesis in 1982-84. Two floppy drives. 20 years later, that's where we are. Okay. Technology. You see the leaps and bounds of technology that we have been to. And we have all these gadgets that we don't want our children to have, but we would like to have ourselves. Given that this is the jump in technology in a span of about 25 years, where are we in the university education system? Have we changed? Have we kept ourselves in pace with the requirement? Surprisingly, some of these universities actually produced these students, did they? Who changed this technology. So we have to worry about the role of the universities in the future. Some thought processes are given here. Of course, we will have a large discussion. Universities have not only to be accessible when their gates are open, but even when their formal gates are closed. Therefore, it's important for continued access, easy and just in time. And we have to have the peer groups inside the university system and networks. Because the university no longer caters to its own students, but the community in which the university is established. It is important now to establish the link with the communities through these online interactions, MOOCs, various forms of learning management systems in the past, MOOCs now, and maybe something else in the future. But it's important to encourage the interactions and dialogues on a continuous basis, and also on a continuous feedback mechanism to see how you can do things better. And it's obviously very, very important to build that feedback in the development and design process itself. And there are strategies for challenges. This is only for e-learning. It doesn't mean it's for e-learning only, but it's in general. We have to bring in partners from the industry. And currently, I am involved in a skilling industry project with the National Association for the Software Sector, the NASSCOM. We will talk about it next time when some development have actually happened. It's important to build interactions with the industry in the university setup. And you have to upgrade the program's content. And we still have to go down. The university has to help in getting the school education organized, because a better school education means a better input to the university system. Therefore, the university cannot be hands-on and say, no, no, it's not my job to deal with the schools. It's important, because your input determines what your output would be. And therefore, it's very, very important to do a lot of these online and offline examination certification processes and so on. So these are all requirements. And when we talk about the technology enhanced learning versus technology enabled learning, the difference is between a sort of a communication. One aspect is a communication availability. The other is more like a cognitive ability to understand things better using better visual technologies or better technologies and so on. So you have to worry about some of these aspects in the university teaching learning processes itself. We have Professor Fatak yesterday talk about the kind of involvement that he has had in teacher enablement, teacher education, in tens of thousands. Talk to a teacher for, you know, at one point of time, it didn't make sense to me that 10,000 teachers to learn, it's a football stadium. Are we talking about? But he has been able to push that idea through. It's important for universities to move forward and participate. So let me leave the forum for the other speakers to give their views, and then we will have a common discussion on where the roles of the future, the university should be from our point of view.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you for this opportunity. I'll pick a thing which Anand said and start from there. Modular and lifelong. As you know, in the introduction they said, I've been with the Azim Premji Foundation from the beginning. And the Azim Premji Foundation began in 2001, working with government school teachers in the most remote parts of India. The Azim Premji University was actually started after many years of working on the ground there. And in some sense, the genesis of the university is from the work on the ground by the foundation. In 2017, I had the privilege, because of a certain study we are doing, to go across and meet over 200 teachers in rural Karnataka, Uttarakhand, and Rajasthan, trying to meet what they called as good schools and good teachers. It was a very humbling experience, because on one day you will meet an elderly gentleman who was about to retire next month, trying to go across a boulder-stopped road in the hills of Uttarkashi so that he can reach a school at 8:30, when we guys decided to turn back and come back. Okay. On the other hand, we went and met an extremely cheerful lady in another school who starts the day at 4 a.m. cooking for a 10-member joint family, takes a bus, takes a shared auto, then walks 2 kilometers in the slush to her school in the hills. So this is the context which I wanted to build with you, and what a privilege it is that I met 200 of those people. Achhe school, achhe teachers, that's the subject of my study, and each school in fact is a case study by itself. But the reason I begin with that is the point that I began with, modular and lifelong. Whenever and wherever I saw each of these teachers corroborate and say that they were good teachers, one found whether they were 30 or 40 or 58, that they were lifelong learners. Language is a huge problem. So in Karnataka, when I had to work with the teachers there, I used my limited Kannada, and I have a certain survival Kannada and I can speak. But I also had a colleague and we had to converse in Kannada with them. When I went to the north, I had my colleague there, my Hindi is reasonably better, and I was speaking to them. But the language is a huge thing. There were teachers who were teaching, who were building scientific temper with an MA education degree. Okay? And they were marvelous. And I say it from my heart. The reason I say it is that they were all lifelong learners. Number two, the modular aspect of it is very important. In a teacher's life, as I described now, even to get 3 days continuously is a huge challenge. When the foundation does workshops in the summer and the winter, teachers have to then leave whatever they were doing in the few days of holidays and go there and attend those programs. You have to innovate and invent and bring out simple solutions. So we have what is known as a voluntary teacher forum. A voluntary teachers forum is where the teachers by themselves come together, sit together and discuss a topic of their interest. You will invariably find 15 to 20 teachers in the evenings or on a Sunday on their own money coming and doing this. That's what I meant by lifelong teachers. If for these lifelong teachers, there's something that you are able to reach out in the manner we are speaking, then I think the world opens up enormously. Modular. So there's a teacher who says, oh, of course I want to attend that module you're doing on light and heat, because that's particularly going to build my stuff. A teacher says, no, I don't want to do that. I want to do geography and understand how you use maps and the topic of hunters and gatherers so that I can bring a better perspective in social sciences or social studies for the child. So modularity. And I therefore think that every time you have any kind of discussion on this, the whole crux of it is how badly does the teacher on the ground want to learn? And each teacher wants to learn, if my experience of 2017 with those 200 teachers is telling me the truth. At the university, there is always this tension, and I'll share it with all of you. We are a young university, but the tension is between the two, three wicked vertices of a triangle. Speed, scale, and quality. If speed is a friend of the scale, quality is the enemy. Quality and scale is quality and speed I want to be friends, scale is an enemy. Therefore, this tension between speed, scale, and quality is a very wicked problem. That's where innovative solutions have to come out. Teaching is a deeply personal process. What works in one class, as we all know, doesn't work in the next class. What we teach a group of teachers of 20 cannot be similarly replicated in the next 20. Therefore, scalability and replicability are two very, very distinct things, which again are dimensions we must bring into this dialogue. Which brings me to my third point. At the foundation and at the university, therefore, we're looking at translations as a huge initiative. There is a huge dearth of material in Hindi and in Kannada, of course in other languages. But the bandwidth is so limited that if we at least attempt something in Kannada and Hindi, then at least with Hindi you cover the northern part of India with material, and you cover Karnataka where we are based, our university is here. To develop and generate people who can translate and then produce those materials is something that is an enormous process. You can have very nice bar graphs from place time to time saying 2.5 million words translated in two, and you won't believe it, 3 million words translated. But that's the kind of challenges we face. If you bring out a very good accessible magazine for teachers in English, the Hindi translation and the Kannada translation is 3 months behind. There is a phase gap. If you reduce the cycle time and manage to bring out the Hindi translation within 1 month of the English version, then you have done something great. So I wanted to place the context of this in the picture. That's about how the challenges of reaching a large population of keen lifelong learners is going to be, because language is going to be the challenge, and how you bring translation initiatives up in the forefront. So modularity, lifelong learning, the challenge of language, translations being critical. The fifth point is something that's dear to me. And I think whatever we do now or in the future, and we are an infant in university, I think the basics are all too critical. So whatever we may speak of, whatever the future holds, I think the most important thing is, are we getting our basics right? And the basics have to be got right from day one. Even day five or day 10 is late. You know, 7 years old, we've done some things. It's not a smooth graph. It is a complex, agonizing thing. But hopefully, on a logarithmic scale, 6 years is nothing, okay? But the point is this. Where do we begin when we say basics have to be right? The basics have to be right when we have a clear vision. In some senses, the university is at an advantage because we have a very clear social purpose. Ours is a philanthropic university established so that we can contribute to education development domain, so that people who learn from here and with whom we learn and grow can go back into the ground and contribute in education and development. So we have a very clear social purpose. The vision is very clear. It's a huge advantage. So therefore, when we recruit, the hiring has to be brilliant. The hiring has to be such that the faculty who join us do not join us for other considerations, and the primary consideration is their alignment and resonance with the vision of the university and with the social purpose of the university. When that happens, from the very limited experience that I have, freedom and autonomy become automatic. Because when you recruit brilliantly, you have that much confidence in the people who join you, and therefore autonomy and freedom is not something that you gift. It becomes a natural part of it. If you don't recruit brilliantly and you have some restrictions, then the toxic broth of red tape, bureaucracy, etc. comes in. So therefore, the importance of recruiting brilliantly, therefore unleashing autonomy and freedom. What does this mean actually? It actually means that when you have this wicked triangle of speed, scale, and quality to discuss, when there are different pulls among 100 faculty for one guy saying quality, one guy saying speed, and the other guy saying scale, 100 people, because of that glue called vision and social purpose, are able to engage together and try to make meaning of this wicked triangle. How wicked is this triangle? And how difficult is this challenge for these 100, 150 faculty to come to? When you say a course should be on Moodle, even the Moodle is such a discriminant. 50 people will be onto it like a flash, 30 with some help, and 20 will be finding it formidable. Okay? That's the mix of people who come together and say that I want to create a program where people go out as reflective practitioners. Do they understand perspectives in curriculum studies? Do they understand how a child learns? Or do they understand what sustainability means when I'm teaching development? And therefore, I want to conclude by saying that the basics have to be very right. When these faculty come together and they get involved in admissions, then they realize what a diverse student community we need. Now, diversity of a student community when you're face to face is X. When you're tomorrow thinking of the future, you can imagine what it means. I want to conclude here by saying basics are very important. Thank you very much.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. I'm with MeritTrac, which is a Manipal global education company. And what I wanted to cover today was our experiences in some of the things that we've been talking about over the last 2 days. What have we tried out in our group? What has been some of our learnings? What have been some of the challenges? So that's really what I would like to cover. So University of Future, I'll talk a little bit about my point of view on how learning is changing, which kind of resonates with a lot of other people who've spoken earlier. We'll talk, give you a case study of how we have done digital learning in a university. I'll also give you another case study of integrating a MOOC with one of our universities, one of our colleges. And also, I think there was a good discussion on, for the University of the Future, employability readiness and what our views on that. So let me start with how learning is changing. I think, and a lot of people have spoken about this, but quickly, I think the old form of learning was all the same content, same learning pace for all. But in the future, it's going to be individualized learning, and that's going to happen pretty quickly, and we've heard that over the last couple of days. Delivery in the old model was once in a while, you come, sit in a lecture, learn it, whereas now it's going to be frequent and continuous learning. The third aspect is typically in India, it was focusing on one discipline. But I think now there is a big opportunity to make it multi-disciplines, across disciplines. That's what is the new model. The next point was that it was expensive and long duration. And we've heard this in the last session also. It's going to become cheaper and shorter sprints, micro-credentialing. Those are the kinds of things that will happen. And the final thing was that the outcomes were measured only through the final exams or the midterm exams. But I think there's going to be outcomes which are going to get measured in intervals in different forms. And that's the other way learning is going to change. All this, to a large extent, is going to get enabled by digital and technology. But I think people have probably underestimated the challenges in this. I mean, we've been doing this for some time. So we have Manipal ProLearn, which is an online skilling marketplace where we have people who come and take courses online. We've also got a distance education university in our group, which is Sikkim Manipal University. And the completion rates of online in ProLearn, et cetera, were a challenge. And we went through some introspection on what we need to do there. When it came to distance education, we were forced to kind of change ourselves. What happened was, around 4 years back, the government changed the rules. And earlier, in the distance education space, we had something called learning centers in different parts of India. All the universities could tie up, and the teaching was actually done in those learning centers. But then the government came and said that you have to shut down all these learning centers, you have to teach from the place you're located. So overnight, we had to completely change our model, right from admission, counseling, payments, learning, etc., everything to be done online. And that was a big challenge for us. So in a way, I think regulation forced us to rethink and reimagine the way we teach in a distance education fashion. And one of the things that we did, I mean, broadly, I'll also use the triangle, learn, interact, and assess. So in terms of learning, what we figured out was that we created a mobile-based learning platform because our learners, we had almost 60,000 of them spread all across India. They are typically from mid-tier towns, and many of them are working professionals. So how do you get them to learn on the mobile became a big thing. So we had to re-architect our learning management system, which was EduNext, to make it mobile first. And also we had to create content which were more short videos, interactive videos, using concepts like Glassboard. So we had a lot of experts do that. And then, of course, they were supplemented or complemented by live webinars, which were happening from Sikkim. So our faculty was sitting in Sikkim doing live webinars. And these videos and interactive sessions were complementing that. So that was one big thing that we did. The second thing we did was that we introduced a concept of summary cards, which we found very useful for these working professionals because they were used to taking, if you remember, all of us, you know, we used to have those short note cards. And so we had to come up with something similar to that. And we came up with flashcards, where we had to summarize every unit into a few bullet points, which people could kind of refresh while they were in a bus or while they were, you know, on the way to office. So this is another thing that we did. The third thing which we did was that we made the reading mobile friendly. So we converted all our PDFs into EPUB format. so that the same experience that you get of reading on a desktop, you would get it on mobile. If you ever tried reading a PDF on a mobile, you know what I'm talking about. So we had to completely change that into an EPUB format, give it a Kindle kind of a feel, look and feel. So that was, again, something which was very, very useful. The other thing that we had to do from an interaction perspective was, and some of the challenges which have been spoken earlier, how do you make online learning completion rates improve? What are the challenges? So we had, like everybody else, we had challenges. How do you ensure that people stick to it? What is the way in which they get the peer pressure from your other classmates in a physical classroom? So those were the things that we had to work on. And I think we did something interesting. So we created a concept of an academic advisor. So these were not the faculty. That we had, of course, a faculty of over 30 people, but we created academic advisors. Each of them were responsible for around 500 students. So they had to reach out to these 500 students proactively, check with them whether they've been submitting their assignments on time, what are they doing to ensure that they're completing stuff, et cetera, et cetera. So they became a mentor for the cohort of 500 to 700 students and tracking the progress. So this was another thing that we did. So as somebody was saying in the morning, as you think about educational future, it's not just about the content. You need to rethink how you give that experience, how do you ensure that people complete. So this was another innovation that we did. We also introduced AI, since Andrew started off with AI in the morning, we introduced the AI chatbot because, as you can imagine, we had 50, 60,000 learners. It was practically impossible for us to be responding to learning questions for our faculty very quickly. So we created an AI bot, put it, trained it with all the learning content of the courses that we were teaching. So the AI bot got experience with that. And then if you ask a question on elasticity of demand, it would give you an answer and also give you content like a video or a document which most dealt with that particular question. So this is again something which our students found very, very interesting. So these were some of the ways in which we tried to make it as interactive as possible. And then of course we did a lot of things from a help desk perspective to answer their queries and do all of that. In terms of assessments, we had to rethink the way we do assessments. Of course, we did quizzes and discussion forums. All the things that you've been hearing about is something that we did a lot. But another thing we did in IT was we created a programming environment where people, instead of downloading their entire compilers onto their machine, could just go onto a browser and any language that they wanted, Java, Python, R, they could start coding on that and then learn on that and then get assessed on that. So that's something that we did from a from an IT perspective. And the other thing which we did, and this was very useful because the time it took to create an environment dramatically came down. And then the final thing we did on the assessment was we created Viva-Versi in a very different way. So typically, Viva-Versi is synchronous. So if you think about it from a distance education mode, somebody has to be doing that Viva and somebody has to be listening to them in a synchronous mode. So we changed that, made it a synchronous Viva-Versi. They were given a short period of time where they had to kind of create the video, and then the assessments could happen at a later point in time by the faculty. So this is another thing that we, innovation that we did, which changed the model. So these were some of the ways in which, and then finally, the descriptive answers, also we made it into a digital evaluation. So we scanned all the descriptive answers, which were the, typically the final exams, put it on the online, and our evaluators were spread all across India so they could evaluate it, and it brought down the time it takes to evaluate, improved the quality of evaluation dramatically. So these are some of the things that we did to completely change how the online model works. And the reason I'm bringing this up is that the government has come up with an online policy. It's in the draft stage. Online degrees are going to be awarded. Now it'll kind of replace distance education going forward. The policy will come out anytime soon. When that happens, universities can give online degrees. In India, degree is still very important. While we think that credentials, micro-credentials are going to become more common, to the reskilling market that's going to be big, but a large proportion of the market still want degrees. And I think the online policy will enable that, but you need to have a model which will make that work. So that was a very quick thing on what we did. The next quick case study I'll talk about is integrating MOOC with School of Management in Manipal University. This was the model that we came up with along with Coursera, saying that on the x-axis, what is the level of academic integration? Is it no credit? Shall we give them some credit? Can it become an elective? Can it become a core curriculum? That's on the x-axis. And then the y-axis is what is the support that the university will give? Will it be just a self-paced learning that the student needs to do? Can it be a faculty support all the way to flipped class? So this is the kind of model that we came, which I thought would be useful for all of you to look at, as to how do you integrate an online course into a core curriculum? And then we did this experiment with one school of management, and we brought in into their first year, third term course, we supplemented a marketing mix course from a Coursera course called IE, European School Marketing Mix Program. 116 students took it. We had a 3-month course. The key thing here, what we did was, it was faculty assisted. So people learned on their own, but every week there was a discussion where the faculty was present, and they kind of discussed with the faculty. The internal assessment was based on the Coursera marks, which, as you all know, is typically, it's an honor code. You're supposed to do it on your own. There's no proctoring. But the final term exam was an exam which was set by the university. So it was a proctored invigilation. So that was the other case study that we did. So I'll just stop here. At these are the two interesting things that we did on how the university of the future will look like. I feel that the university of future will be very different from what it is today. But as people said, it's very difficult to predict. So we'll see how it goes. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I appreciate both of you sticking to the program. It was a very nice summary of what you are trying to do as a new university, and also his experience of how the university in the future may have to put the distance education or online education as part and parcel of the whole thing. And my general introduction was on what the future of the education should be. The floor is open for discussion, and I would like to invite members to. Yes.
Morning, I'm Parmeshwaran from MHRD. I'd like to know, what is the percentage of completion in the online courses you had? What's your experience on that?
Yeah, that's a very good thing, sir. So in Manipal ProLearn, which is a reskilling, upskilling kind of a program, our completion rates were earlier in the 40% kind of a range. And then some of the things that I talked about that we did in the distance education space, the same thing we were doing there, and we managed to pull the completion rates to around 75 to 80%. It was not an easy thing to do. We had to do several things, including somebody calling out to the students, telling them, have you kind of done your work, etc. So it's unlike some of the other models which we've talked about, which is purely technology-based, student does everything, it's completely automated. At least in India, we found that blending it is another way to think about it very differently.
See, these are students who are actually taking the degree, and therefore completion is in their own interest. So what he does is, no, they are in the part of the course.
Hello. Did you find any correlation between the performance of the proctored exam and the online exam? Mm. Because we found that in our blended MOOCs experience.
Yeah, that's a good
and,
one.
And the point I'm making is, eventually we'll have to go to a place where we could have most of the assessment acknowledged through online process.
Yeah, I think this was a very important discussion that the college had, frankly speaking, and they were kind of figuring out what should be the model. Their model was 70% was internal assessment and 30% was a final exam. Yes, now, if you have to suddenly depend on the Coursera platform for that 70% marks, they had a serious question whether they should do it this way or not. And the eventual outcome was that they found that there was a correlation. In fact, a case study has been published by them. On this pilot, there was a case study, there was a correlation that generally people who did well on the internal assessment did okay on the remote proctoring. But the only difference here I would like to reiterate, this was a blended thing. The faculty was involved every week. So it was not a purely online model.
So were the students getting two certificates? I mean, one is they're passing your exam, and second is they're getting a separate certificate from Coursera?
Yes, so the model, yeah. So the university, of course, they clear that course and they get, it is a key part of their thing. They also get an added certificate from Coursera, and so that was the advantage.
So what is the reception from the students community?
It was interesting. The students we picked a hard course, frankly speaking, because it was in 3 months they had to finish a specialization that Coursera talked about, which is not just one course, but actually it's 4 courses. And they felt it was a pressure, and then but they liked it. They gave a couple of interesting things, that the case studies were not Indian, so that they found it interesting. You know, how do you make the Indian context, bring it in, because this is business school grads.
Yeah.
The second thing they found very nice was the capstone project, which they had to do, or the final project they had to do, was Tesla, which was a very recent example of a case study. So they found that interesting, that they could get a world-class case study to be done very quickly. So that was the good feedback that they gave.
So overall, it was a good reception from the students.
Good reception, yeah.
Okay. And what about the faculty? What was their, were they threatened that they're being replaced? Or
no, so what the approach we have taken there, the university has taken there, is that the faculty underwent the program slightly before the students. In fact, what we're doing now, we're going to replicate this in other disciplines. The faculty has been made to take these the identified electives upfront.
Now, I have one further question to ask you. See, student feedback is a very important component of faculty performance evaluation at the end of the year. So in this blended model, you know, how do we tackle this issue? Faculty feedback from the students. So, I mean, the locus of control is now with the technology also. So what is the role of faculty?
No, in a
feedback?
Blended model, our view has been therefore that even in our distance education model, where we have faculty teaching as well as we have online content that I talked about, which is the other example that I gave, Sikkim Manipal University. So we do we capture feedback frequently. We actually capture three times. We capture feedback at time of the enrollment, middle of the course, end of the program. And the feedback not only talks about the e-content, but also about the faculty sessions, the webinars that have happened. We capture that information and then we consolidate that and then take action or do things based on that. So I agree with you, the faculty feedback is important and that needs to be captured frequently as you think about doing this.
Sir, I look back at NPTEL videos and MIT OCW videos from a few years ago, my feeling is that the quality of the videos from there is superior to what we had a few years ago. So my question now is, how do you compare the quality of, you know, the production quality of the videos we do here currently and what's going on there versus what will happen in future? And so that's one thing, because now this is online, right? So content to the learner is available from India. It's also available from the US. So that's one thing. The second thing is, why would I want an online degree from an IIT when I could get it from MIT, for example? So how will you tackle this down the road?
You want me to?
Anyone can answer, anyone.
Okay, on the value of, on the quality of the videos, over the years, the quality has slowly moved forward to the, see, NPTEL originally, since you referred specifically to NPTEL, its original mandate was to get the broadcast quality videos done. Therefore, the full form of the videos are not available to you. What is available is a streaming conversion that was done and a compression that was made. But in principle, I think even today, the quality of the videos have over a period improved. That's one aspect. The second thing is the quality of videos is in terms of production and the quality of videos in terms of the content. You have to compare both of them. If you look at it, the contents are curricular based. And therefore, NPTEL provides a much more continuous stream of learning from the first year to the fifth year, whatever period is there. Therefore, if you follow a large number of these things, you will see that the learning component really goes very fast and very steep quickly. So this is my observation. The second, the choice of which university you want to learn from is entirely yours. My only submission to the members here and also in the national mission is that the best of every university should come forward. So somehow be interested to come forward. You have to provide the mechanisms for them to come forward and come up with the educational processes that they are familiar with. The same way 1% of the students who come to IIT stay in, I mean, of the 100%, and then the remaining 99% does not mean that the 99% will not learn. What is important is if you cannot admit students into your system, you can open up your learning process to everybody, and that can be picked up by many institutions. This way, the gradation between the tiers over a period disappears. There's a continuous process of learning. Therefore, the choice of, if you think that one particular institutional quality video is excellent for you, go with it. I don't think there's a discussion, that's a point to be discussed. What is important is Do you get such qualities across in every learning that you want to do from every institution? That's what we are trying to promote. The future of the university is to open its doors outwards, not simply inwards, by taking hundreds of students more and another 10,000 faculty more. No, it's not going to happen. What is important is the best of what you have, make it available and make the process of instruction also available to them. This is the direction in which I would normally think, but unless the other members have to say something on it.
Yeah, I just have one other point. I mean, like Sundar already mentioned, the gross enrollment ratio in India is still at around 30%. So while when the online degree policy comes, it's actually going to benefit a lot of people who don't have access. What Giridhar also very rightly said, I mean, a lot of people don't have access to good education. So I think the distance education market, which is kind of catering to that, will get replaced dramatically by the online degree market. So that cohort of students will suddenly get access to good content, good colleges in India itself, because it'll be much cheaper than getting a degree from MIT, which they may not want to do.
I've got a quick question. Discussing over the last 2 days, what I observe is, don't you think all these, when we are talking about higher education and online education, looking at the point which Giridhar said, with school dropouts, don't you think we are going to create more remote, rural, urban divide in education? Yeah. See, while on one side we are talking about higher education, online learning and other things, on the other hand, we have greater socioeconomic problems, where we are still fighting with the school dropouts and issues of that. Don't you think this will create more bigger divides in the society in terms of education that we are talking about?
So this is a
So
this is a larger question that you asked. And it is a fact that if you want to look at priorities, then school education is really the priority. Okay?
Yeah, that's right.
School education is the priority. And the key to that is the teacher. Today, our teacher comes from a very suboptimal graduation, undergrad program. The teacher also comes from a very pathetic or abysmal teacher education program.
Absolutely.
Okay, that's a fact. Therefore, all our efforts must be on what can we do with school education. Because only then will you then create whatever is possible, you build
that's
on that.
Exactly what I want.
Therefore, capacity building of teachers is very important. So as a university, if we are building programs, we'll probably put out, let's say, even in very high volumes, 1,000, 2,000 teachers. But the 5 million teachers who are there, with an average 20 years career ahead of them, how do you build capacity for those people is really the challenge. Simultaneously looking forward, I think we must give a lot of attention to our undergrad programs. Because I think the Gordian knot, if you have to cut, you might as well cut it at the undergrad.
Thank you very much. I think that's a big issue.
Just a quick response to him in addition to that. Sir, what you expressed was, this was our primary problem. If I go back to 1999, when we were discussing the NPTEL and others, the primary question posed on us was, what about the children's education? Because that determines your input and so on. We obviously, IITs took a stand that we do not have the necessary expertise to teach the children directly, but we may as well do only a teacher empowerment for the educational teams, and the teachers may have to carry the message forward. I think today, government is so seriously concerned with it. If I understand, I think Parameshwaran might be able to give me more details. This National Institute of Open Schooling did a 15 lakh teacher training on what is the four language channels. Something is happening with respect to mass scaling and reaching out to the teachers. And the very idea of the Swayam Prabha project, which we will have in the afternoon, the very idea of a television project at this point of time, when the networks are coming out and the mobiles are coming up, is that more than 35 to 40% of our students do not have any network available to them, but they have TVs at home. Therefore, it's possible, every village, every point has at least TVs at home. Therefore, it's possible for us to do some streamlining and ensuring that they are being taken into account, they are being taken care of. And so, efforts are there, but as you said, to get our higher education teachers to this side so far has taken us so long. But I hope it doesn't take this long, 20 years, for the teacher education and the teachers to come online. But teaching children is through games. It's not through the standard methods that we do. Therefore, the technology there is a very, very different requirement. I think we have to worry about pedagogies much more. That should be our priority. I agree with you on that. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you all. Big round of applause. I now request Professor Mangal Sundar to hand over mementos to the two speakers as a token of our gratitude.
I'm supposed to give it to him, right? Yeah. So I wasn't sure what he would say. No, even for that, I would say thanks.
Yeah. Mr. Giridhar Rao, thank you so much for being part of our session today. May I request Professor Fartak to hand over the memento to the session chair.
I thought I'd wait because it's back to take. So nice of you, Professor Fartak.